When we hear the word Red Scare nowadays, we probably think of the following. McCarthyism, blacklists, Senate hearings, witch hunts, suspected communists.
Have you no sense of decency, sir? At long last.
Many people in America are still with us who lived through that era. If you're one of them, then you know the stories of betrayal, hysteria, and brief glimpses of courage in the face of unbridled paranoia. It's not a surprise to me in that case that a lot of people don't realize that the, quote, Red Scare of the 1950s that we all know was actually the second Red Scare. Some may be familiar with the history of the Soviet Union and the United States, that being, in an abridged version, revolution and everybody hates the Soviets. Whoops, Stalin. Lots of death. Hitler, Hitler, Hitler. Okay, Stalin, we'll be friends. Thanks for not letting Hitler take Russia. Haha, you thought we were going to forget your evil? Also, business, business, money, money. Red Scare, Red Scare, Red Scare. Plenty will realize that a lot of nothing seems to happen between the US and the Soviet Union from the revolution of 1917 until we had to ally with Stalin to beat Hitler. Then, within 2 years, the Soviets were the most evil, evil thing that ever eviled. Look, I understand that Stalin is, you know, Stalin. But even then, the whole world is about to go through a massive transformation in geopolitical affairs, and you might want to try and work with the country which is quickly becoming a superpower, possibly on your level. Just maybe. But no. Just like that, we're banning being a commie and we're making movies about the great Satan, I mean Stalin. That's the important thing, though. We were used to this approach to left-wing ideologies. We had been since the Soviet Union was established, which, if you don't know, is when the first Red Scare took place. It's an incredible saga of paranoia, overreaches of power, a little class struggle here and there, deportations, and an unsung hero who helped bring the whole affair down. So here we go, back to the beginning. Fair warning, I'm going to have to backtrack in the timeline at least once. The shot that broke the world. On June 28, 1914, the heir presumptive to the throne of Austria-Hungary, Archduke Franz Ferdinand, was riding in a motorcade with his wife Sophia through the Bosnian town of Sarajevo. The pair were on a diplomatic and personal visit, and had only just earlier that day survived an attempted bombing by the Black Hand, a Serbian nationalist group who wanted to break off Austria-Hungary's South Slav provinces to form a Yugoslavia. While approaching the Latin bridge over the river Miljaka, Ferdinand and Sophia's motorcade was approached by one of the earlier attackers, a 19-year-old Bosnian Serb named Gavrilo Princip, who opened fire with a Belgian-made semi-automatic pistol into the Archduke and Duchess. Within 10 minutes, both had died from the multiple gunshot wounds. Word traveled swiftly to Ferdinand's uncle, the Emperor of Austria-Hungary, Franz Joseph, who spent a month considering his options before declaring war on Serbia, setting off a chain of similar declarations from allied nations like dominoes, one after the other. Alliances, which had kept a delicate peace for decades, drew the lines of battle until World War I had engulfed the entire continent. Most were ready for war, more or less, but for one nation, war was a death knell for the established order. Imperial Russia. While the country's entry was met with widespread public approval based on pan-Slavic sympathies, the Battle of Tannenberg killed all of that. The Eastern Front became a brutal war of attrition, leading to the deaths of almost 10 million Russians, a destruction of the nation's finances, supply lines, and infrastructure. There was such anger towards the royals and elites among the populace for these hardships that finally, after the February Revolution of 1917, Tsar Nicholas II abdicated the throne and officially ended over 300 years of Tsarist rule in Russia. About 1 month later, an exiled Marxist revolutionary living in Switzerland was arriving by train in Petrograd. That revolutionary was none other than Vladimir Lenin, and with the October Revolution of the same year, he became the leader of a new one-party communist state known then as the Russian Soviet Federative Socialist Republic. Lenin's first priority was to withdraw Russia from World War I, which he accomplished by signing the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk with Germany, infuriating the Allied powers and turning pretty much the entire Western world against the Soviet Union. So that's why we first started hating the Soviets. Partly. Bombermen and anarchy. As for the state side of things, we'd already been building a distrust and animosity towards labor, socialist, and anarchist activists for decades before the revolution. Arguably, it started on May 4th, 1886 in Haymarket Square, Chicago, in what became known as the Haymarket Affair. A peaceful labor demonstration supporting workers striking for an 8-hour workday and in reaction to the recent killings of several workers by police. Suddenly, a still unknown person threw a dynamite bomb at the police trying to disperse the meeting. 11 people were killed and over 100 injured in the ensuing gunfire, and over 100 were arrested. 8 anarchists were convicted of conspiracy, 7 sentenced to death, and 1 to 15 years in prison. 2 of these sentenced to death had their sentences commuted by the governor, Richard Oglesby, and a 3rd committed suicide before the execution. In all, 4 of the convicted were hanged on November 11, 1887. The whole affair sent shockwaves through the international labor movement, helping to build itself up even further and commemorate May 1st as the Universal Day for Labor Solidarity. However, it also heightened public fear of the movement's radical anarchist and socialist elements. Basically, from Haymarket until the US entry into World War I, left-wing activism hit the ground running and gave hell to all the robber barons and capitalists, which everyone should be on board with and support. Henry George, Emma Goldman, Daniel DeLeon, Mark Twain, W.E.B. Du Bois, Mother Jones, Helen Keller, and many others rose to prominence in this era, and rightly so. However, like any movement, in my own view, a far more militant faction begins to rear its head, for better or worse. The epicenter of this faction's rise, as far as I have found, was in Paterson, New Jersey. Jersey represent. In around the same stretch of time as the left-wing rise, Paterson saw a massive influx of southern Italian immigrants at a time when discrimination against Italians was reaching a fever pitch. Look, the late 1800s were a crazy time to be alive. There were lynchings of them across the South, same way it was with African Americans, which helped breed radical anarchist leanings in the second wave, along with a general distrust of authority thanks to their experiences with police and the Italian government back home. Oh, and the Mafia! That's where that got started. Being transplanted from Sicily and the impoverished corners of southern Italy to the major cities of America. At any rate, by 1900, the Italian community, at least in Paterson, was primed and ready for whatever was waiting down the road. Enter Luigi Galiani. Galiani had been an anarchist since he was a teenager, and had been jailed and/or chased out of his native Italy, Switzerland, France, Britain, and Egypt for his actions under the banner of this ideology. Then, in 1901, at the age of 40, Galiani made his way to America and landed in Paterson, New Jersey, quickly becoming a leading anarchist orator and leader. He was a firebrand advocate of what is called propaganda of the deed, which in other words means taking specific political action as an example to others and as a catalyst for revolution. This approach to political revolution almost always is violent by its very nature, which is borne out by the string of assassinations and attempted assassinations of European/American rulers and business leaders between the 1870s and 1910s by self-professed anarchists. You may or may not remember that U.S. President William McKinley, only a year after Galiani arrived in America, was shot and killed by a Polish-American factory worker/anarchist Leon Czolgosz, who was inspired by the assassination of the King of Italy the same year by another anarchist. At any rate, Galiani's brand of activism was far more direct and destructive than others. After a decade and some change of riling up the anarchist community in America, Galiani spent the years 1914 and 1919, when he was deported back to Italy, and even up to 1932, with his Gallienist followers carrying out a string of politically motivated bombings of prominent politicians and capitalists, who they saw as enemies of the working class, culminating in their suspected involvement in the 1920 Wall Street bombing that killed 38 people and injured 400 others. But before that, there came the bombing campaign that sets our actual story in motion. The May Day Action of 1919. Between April and June of 1919, the Gallienists mailed parcel bombs to Seattle Mayor Ole Hansen, a known conservative opponent of radicals, former Georgia Senator Thomas Hardwick, a sponsor of the Anti-Radical Immigration Act of 1918, and Attorney General A. Mitchell Palmer, a proponent of anti-radical and anti-sedition policies. None of them were successful in actually killing the intended target, though Senator Hardwick's servant, who picked up the package, had her hands blown off, and of course portions of their house was destroyed. However, while the bombings may have been a catalyst for the government to act, the coming summer of 1919 would only give them more fear to capitalize on. They don't call it the Red Summer for nothing. The Red Summer. Historically in America, when war ends and the soldiers come home, a whole bunch of home front wars begin as we try to figure out what the new normal is. World War I was no different, and combined with all of the other domestic conflicts that had been brewing, the results were explosive. This is going to take a bit of contextualizing, so bear with me. So by the time the 20th century was getting into its second decade, nativist/isolationist ideology had taken fast hold in American immigration policy, with blanket bans on certain immigrants. Then the U.S. entered the Great War, and suddenly the industrial hubs in New England and the Midwest experienced labor shortages, which wasn't being supplanted by new immigrant crop because there weren't any. Where, then, would capitalists and industrialists find cheap labor alternatives? The South, in the form of 500,000 African Americans making the first Great Migration trek to the big northern cities, Chicago, New York, Boston, Detroit, etc., which kept going until 1940. They replaced traditionally white jobs in factories, on railroads, all the most important and growing industries. In some cities, black workers were even used as strike breakers, particularly during the mass strikes of 1917, which only served to inflame tensions between white workers, first-generation immigrants, and black workers. As you might expect in 1910's America, this sparked a series of anti-black race riots in various major cities in 1917. Okay, now fast forward 2 years, and add in the following. Rapid demobilization of the military with no plan to reintegrate veterans into the workforce, and sudden removal of wartime price controls, both of which led to a spike in unemployment and inflation, and thus an increased competition for jobs, and a steep rise in anti-Bolshevik sentiments in America after the Russian Revolution, and a fear that an imminent attempt to overthrow the U.S. government and establish a similar Soviet system, the African-American community's advocate of racial equality and labor rights made them, according to President Woodrow Wilson himself in private conversation, the greatest medium for conveying Bolshevism to America. In other words, black activists were being seen as simply puppets of the Soviet Union, which is where that propaganda tool starts coming up. I'm sure this will end perfectly. Now, America is no stranger to massive race riots in major cities. They've been happening since before the Declaration of Independence was ever written. But never before had we had such a perfect storm, such as in the Red Summer. More importantly, however, unlike just about every race riot against blacks previously, black people actually fought back during this one. Yet more importantly still, is that while pretty much every race riot in the 1800s had been concentrated in the South, the Red Summer spanned all across, with some in the worst of it happening in the North. In a post-riot report to Congress, Dr. George Edmund Haynes, a black sociology scholar and Wilson administration employee, detailed around 38 different cities that experienced race riots, which included, in the rough order they occurred by date, April 13th, Millen, Georgia. May 10th, Charleston, South Carolina and Sylvester, Georgia. May 25th, Milan, Georgia. May 29th, Putnam, Georgia. May 31st, Monticello, Mississippi. June 13th, New London, Connecticut and Memphis, Tennessee. June 27th, Macon, Mississippi and Annapolis, Maryland. July 3rd, Bisbee, Arizona. July 5th, Scranton, Pennsylvania. July 6th, Dublin, Georgia. July 7th, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. July 8th, Coatesville, Pennsylvania. July 9th, Tuscaloosa, Alabama. July 10th, Longview, Texas. July 11th, Baltimore, Maryland. July 15th, Port Arthur, Texas. July 19th through 23rd, Washington, D.C. July 21st, Norfolk, Virginia. July 23rd, New Orleans, Louisiana and Darby, Pennsylvania. July 26th, Hobson City, Alabama. July 27th through August 3rd, Chicago, Illinois. July 28th, Newbury, South Carolina. July 31st, Bloomington, Illinois, Syracuse, New York, and Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. August 4th, Hattiesburg, Mississippi. August 5th, Lexington, Nebraska. August 6th, Texarkana, Texas. August through September, Baltimore, Maryland. August 18th, Mulberry, Florida. August 21st, New York City. August 27th through 28th, Lawrence County, Georgia. August 29th, Ogilmie, Georgia. August 30th, Knoxville, Tennessee. September 16th, New York City again. September 25th through 28th, Omaha, Nebraska. October 1st, Elaine, Arkansas. October 4th through 5th, Gary, Indiana. October 9th, Donora, Pennsylvania. October 10th, Hubbard, Ohio. October 30th, Corbin, Kentucky. And November 22nd, Bogalusa, Louisiana. There is, albeit a slim possibility, that whoever's watching could live in one of the cities just mentioned. Several notable things to address, besides the sheer number of riots. Pretty much every time the police refuse to intervene against the literal white lynch mobs, black people and activists would fight back themselves. This was one of, if not the only, example of white-led race riots facing resistance from the black victims. Might I reiterate that there were literal white lynch mobs that we have photos of hunting for black people to attack? As for specifics of certain riots, the Washington, D.C. riots required President Wilson to mobilize the National Guard after the police just refused to do anything. In Norfolk, Virginia, white residents attacked a homecoming celebration for African-American veterans of the war. Just heap on that cruelty, you know? In Chicago, the police again did nothing when a young black man was stoned and drowned after treading into a segregated neighborhood, and black citizens picked up the slack in the ensuing battle. At the end, there were 38 casualties, 537 injured folk, and over 1,000 black families were left homeless. In Knoxville, a white lynch mob formed after a black man was arrested for the suspected rape of a white woman. They broke into a county jail, freeing 16 white prisoners, some murderers, before attacking the town's black business district, leaving 7 dead and 20 more wounded. In Omaha, a mob of around 10,000 attacked and burned down the county courthouse to force the police to release to them, surprise, surprise, a black suspect for the rape of a white woman. The mob then proceeded to lynch the suspect, Will Brown, by hanging him and then burning his body. Then they started attacking the black business district in North Omaha. Finally, in Elaine, Arkansas, white resistance to black sharecroppers unionizing and fears of socialism led to one white man being fatally shot in a confrontation trying to prevent a meeting of a local chapter of the Progressive Farmers and Household Union of America. A militia was formed specifically to arrest the African-American farmers, but of course they acted more like a lynch mob than anything else. In one day, they viciously murdered between 100 and 237 black people, making it one of the bloodiest racial conflicts in United States history. Following the violence, Governor Charles Hillman Broff organized a committee to investigate the riot. which just happened to consist of prominent local white businessmen. Unsurprisingly, they concluded that the sharecroppers' union were socialists who were trying to organize black people together to kill white people. What would become known as the FBI came down and filed about 9 reports stating there was no evidence of any conspiracy to murder, even though they didn't even interview any of the actual sharecroppers. Additionally, the local government of Elaine tried 79 blacks with, of course, all white juries. 12 were sentenced to death for murder, while the rest had to accept prison terms up to 21 years. Luckily, the NAACP began launching appeals for some of the defendants, which made their way all the way to the Supreme Court in Moore v. Dempsey, 1923. The first case directly addressing the mob domination of trials against black people in the South, and how it deprived them of due process. It was a step in the right direction, but not much more. Now, let's consider something which I mentioned earlier. Race riots in America are nothing new, and certainly weren't new in 1919. However, what changed in these riots was that black people, encouraged by the burgeoning civil rights movement, fought back against their oppression. The natural explanation for this by the established order was that black people were being directly controlled by the Soviet Union through propaganda meant to undermine the United States. There's some truth in that, but not in the way the old segregationists convinced themselves it was. Socialism and communism inspired many black Americans to fight for their rights, for sharecroppers to unionize against the forces of the white bourbon South, and, more importantly, fight the racial violence they were facing. I mean, I've briefly mentioned this before, but W.E.B. Du Bois, one of the most influential figures in the history of the American civil rights movement, believed capitalism was the prime cause of racism, confidently supported the principles of socialists and communists, and identified as a communist openly on multiple occasions. This whole event was a turning point for not just anarchists, socialists, communists, and the like, but for the civil rights movement in specifically turning against the conciliatory approaches of Booker T. Washington to a more direct and forward approach. Of course, the Bureau of Investigations was not very pleased with these developments in the black community. A young conservative Justice Department employee named J. Edgar Hoover's first assignment was to carry out something which would become known as the Palmer Raids, the actual focus of what I'm talking about, as opposed to the mountain of backstory I just laid out. I suppose to wrap this up, I should mention that a full half of the Justice Department reports on the threats of Bolshevism and radicalism were from the black community, and Hoover himself blamed most of the riots on crimes committed by black people in the area. Seems he had found his calling. Anyhow, I'm separating this topic into more than one video. I just wanted to lay the groundwork for what I'm talking about, and I'll pick it up again by discussing A. Mitchell Palmer, the Attorney General, some bombings, the Palmer Raids, and Lewis F. Post, an unsung hero of this saga. So, thank you for watching, and I hope you'll be back for part 2. Like, comment, subscribe, I'd very much appreciate that. Always happy to hear from people's opinions on my content, preferably stated politely. And also, ring the bell to notify yourself when I upload. I keep forgetting to say that. And with that, thanks again for watching.